history and the traditions surrounding NYU. And I was really particularly drawn to the fact that at its inception, this college was designed to provide a university education to the common man, something that was available to everyone, not something granted just by birthright, as had been the tradition. And I really hope that our dialogue this evening is in keeping with that tradition, that we are discussing ideas that are relevant to all of us in a way that all of us can engage. And I can't think of any better discussion to be having this evening on the anniversary of 9/11 than to be discussing concepts of justice and forgiveness, because these are really concepts that are applicable and vital to all of us. They are interesting to me on a philosophic level because they seem very antagonistic towards each other, but they're also very deeply personal concepts to me. And they're really concepts that all of us have to wrestle with, because regardless of your background and where you came from, all of us have been in some way or another wounded, many of us very deeply. And we have to wrestle with what we do with that. What do we do with that pain? Is there hope to be found? Is there life and healing after suffering severe trauma? And conversely, and maybe just as importantly, all of us to some degree or another, myself included, have wounded other people and also need forgiveness from those that we have wounded. And so wrestling with these concepts of justice and forgiveness are vital both for our personal healing and for understanding our own need for forgiveness. Most of you are likely aware of my story, and it's been recapped a little bit. But the reason that these concepts are so personal to me is because of suffering violation at a very personal level, sexual assault. The first time I was assaulted, it was actually by a member of my church, and I was 7 years old. I was very fortunate because there were adults in that church who recognized the warning signs of grooming, and they came and they warned my parents. And so the assault and the abuse was stopped before it became too severe. But it doesn't take a lot to do very much damage. And the damage was really compounded by my church, because when my parents took steps to protect me, the response of the adults that had surrounded me, that formed my concept of God, that formed my concept of church family, was to respond very metropolitically. Because I had not verbalized the abuse, I hadn't proved it. And because I hadn't proved it, these adults were not motivated to protect me, but they were motivated to isolate me and my family. So at 7 years old, I lost everything that formed my concept of church, that formed my concept of God and faith. And all of these adults that I had trusted and looked up to were treating me just terribly, and I couldn't understand why. When I was around 12, I started to process more, to understand more what had happened. So I shared with my parents the abuse that had occurred, and I started to ask more questions. And when I found out why I had lost everything at 7 years old, the message that I internalized was, if you can't prove it, don't speak up, because you will lose everything. And like so much of the messages we internalize with trauma, I didn't even realize I had absorbed it. But that really set the stage for what happened just a few years later when I suffered a back injury and walked into the exam room of Larry Nassar. There were a lot of things I knew about Larry at that time. He was the Olympic team doctor. He was the sports medicine physician for U of M, for MSU. He had almost godlike status in the gymnastics world. What I did not know was that by 2000, Larry was a hardened and skilled sexual predator, and he had been sexually abusing children for almost a decade. I did not know that four others had reported Larry's abuse before I even walked in his door. And so when things didn't seem right, my thought process went back to what had happened when I was seven. I can't prove it's abuse. It must be me. The problem must be me. And so I stayed quiet. And for the next year, I stayed quiet. I thought surely at least one of the adults that surrounded me and that surrounded Larry would have done something if there was any question about what he was doing. And what I had to wrestle with when I finally came to grips with the abuse that occurred was that I hadn't just been betrayed by somebody that I trusted. I had been betrayed by everybody that surrounded him. There wasn't anyone I could trust. Not my doctor, not the school, not my coaches. There was no one that I could trust anymore. Eventually, I told my parents, but again, we had no idea what to do. You know, what do you do with information like this? How do you get someone to believe you, especially after you've already been told that you're not going to be believed? I had no way of making anyone listen, and I was terrified of what it would mean for me personally if I were to speak up, because I knew it would become a national story. therefore charged with sexual assault. Most of you probably already know where the story goes, but after 16 years of waiting and watching and wondering if it was ever, ever going to end, I opened my computer one day and I saw a story trending in my Facebook newsfeed. And it was a report written by the Indianapolis Star that detailed USAG's decades-long cover-up of the sexual abuse of coaches. And Larry wasn't in that article, but I knew if the spotlight was on USAG and people were finally understanding the level of corruption in that organization, that maybe for the first time there was a chance that people would believe their own team physician was a serial abuser. And with my teething baby on my back, I wrote to the Indianapolis Star right away. This is what happened. And I can't file a police report anymore because I didn't think I could. I said, but I will give you whatever you need if you can make the truth come out. And then I called my husband who was at work and said, hey, I just did this thing. I had an awesome husband. He said, all right, let's see where it goes. Let's see what God can do. And within a matter of weeks, I had discovered that I could file a police report. We had packed our family up and traveled to Michigan, started the criminal investigative process, started the Title IX process. The Indianapolis Star did come down and record an interview, and within 3 weeks, Larry knew that I had come forward, and I was out there by myself. I had to write some of the hardest emails that I've ever written to family and friends and tell them, this is what happened when I was a little child, and you're gonna see this coming out in the news, and I don't want you to open the front page of the paper and see my face and not hear it from you first. And I felt like I had to give up everything. Every shred of privacy, every shred of dignity, just in an effort to make it stop. And the fallout when my interview went public was every bit as nasty as I expected it to be. But the result was incredible. To this day, over 400 women have now come forward as victims of Larry. He is in prison for the rest of his life. Some of the victims of the child porn have been able to be found. He will never harm another little girl again. Institutions are being held accountable. Leadership structure is changing. And literally the entire world sat and watched as 256 women stood up and gave their victim impact statements and forced society to confront the reality of sexual abuse in ways that had never, ever, never been required to confront it. And the impact is global, but the damage is still very severe. And it took a very long time to get to that point. And these concepts of justice and forgiveness were the concepts that I had to wrestle with for 16 years. And I was terrified to forgive my abuser because society so minimizes the trauma of sexual abuse. They so downplay the devastation that I thought if I forgave my abuser, it would give them one more reason to say, see, this wasn't as bad. Look at how well you've moved on. Look at all the great things that have come because you've released your bitterness. And I didn't want to give anyone one more reason to downplay what had happened to me. So these are some of the dynamics that I want to explore with you today. What is forgiveness? What is justice? How do those two interrelate? And can you have both at the same time? When Jacob and I told our pastors at a former church in Michigan what I was about to do, one of them asked a very insightful question. He asked, is there anything you personally need to get out of this process besides stopping an abuser? And the reason that this question was so vital for me was because if my worth, if my value was based in the decision of 12 jurors, and I didn't succeed, the result to me would be devastating. And so I had to get to the point where I was able to hold on to what was true, regardless of what society said, regardless of what 12 jurors on the jury pool said. My healing had to be founded in something other than a societal response to my abuse. And I was at that place when I reported Larry, but it took years of wrestling to get there. I found beautiful answers to the questions that I saw, and those answers provided a framework for experiencing real healing. And I'd like to do two things tonight as we discuss these concepts. The very first thing we need to do is just define the terms. What do we mean by justice and forgiveness? We don't know the words that we're using. We can't talk about how they apply, right? And then discuss how they intersect and how they impact our life, regardless of the circumstances that we've been through. And as we do that, it's going to become obvious to you, if it hasn't already, that I do come from a Christian worldview. I believe that there is a God who is loving and who is sovereign, and that this God is revealed in the God of the Bible. but I'm not alone in operating from a worldview. Because the reality is that all of us operate from a worldview. We all have a faith structure, whether it is agnostic, atheistic, polytheistic, theistic, all of us have a faith structure that we're operating from, and a lens through which we view life. And we can't discuss these important concepts and dive into philosophical concepts if we're not honest with that up front. So let's just be honest about it. This is the framework that I'm coming from. So what is justice? What do we mean by it? We hear that term used all the time, but what is it? What are its defining characteristics and ideas? I think one of the best ways that we can discuss that is to look at how it's used culturally. And I think one of the greatest cultural icons we have of someone who fought for justice was Martin Luther King Jr. And he has just beautiful writings on both of these concepts, justice and forgiveness. His pursuit and understanding of justice powerfully changed the world, and his writings are as sobering as they are inspiring. King once wrote that his pursuit of justice would involve authority and power, because he knew that you had to have those things to be able to pursue justice. But he wrote, "I am not interested in power for power's sake. I am interested in a power that is moral, that is right, and that is good." So the first thing we see in the pursuit of justice is that it is focused on some sort of moral standard. It's anchored to some sort of moral standard. It differentiates between what is right and wrong, what is bad and what is good, and that's the motivation for seeking it. And he expounded more on these ideas, writing, "Cowardice asks the question, is it safe? Expediency asks the question, is it politic? Vanity asks the question, is it popular? But conscience asks the question, is it right? And there comes a time when we must take a position that is neither safe, nor politic, nor popular, but we must take the position that is right." This right, this pursuit of what was right, this pursuit of justice, to King, was not a standard that was utilitarian. It wasn't based on political expediency. It wasn't based on cultural popularity. It was anchored to morality, to an absolute moral standard, and that was his guidestone. It came from outside human opinion and perception. And his powerful exposition of his pursuit of justice is seen even in very simplistic form if we just go as basic as looking at the dictionary definition. Yeah, I know dictionaries aren't terribly popular tools now and then, but it gives us the elements to define justice. So Merriam-Webster's dictionary defines just in several ways. We're going to see these terms reflected in how Luther and how King used the term justice. So first, just is having a basis or conforming in to fact or reason. Justice is defined as conforming to a standard of correctness, having that moral standard that we're anchored to. It is faithful to an original. It is acting or being in conformity with what is morally upright or good. It is being what is merited or deserved. And these are the elements from the dictionary definition of what the word just means. You see a common thread through these definitions? All of them require some sort of standard, some sort of absolute truth. In the same way that King powerfully taught that we are to ask the question, what is right? We see that justice is comparing something, some event or some action, against a firm, immovable standard. This means two very important things. First, it means that the standard exists. There is some standard. If there is not some standard by which we measure our actions, events, or ideas, there can be no such thing as justice. C.S. Lewis perhaps said it best in his book, Mere Christianity. And this is a quote that I held on to, particularly for the last 2 years. Lewis said, "My argument against God was that the universe seemed so cruel and unjust. But how had I got this idea of just and unjust? A man does not call a line crooked unless he has some idea of a straight line. What was I comparing this universe with when I called it unjust?" And in the same way, Martin Luther King explicitly appeals to the standards of God in his pursuit of justice as the defining characteristic for what we ought to support or oppose. King powerfully wrote, "If any earthly institution or custom conflicts with God's will, it is your duty to oppose it. You must never allow the transitory, evanescent demands of man-made institutions to to take precedence over the eternal demands of Almighty God. Now, for those who wish to dive deeper into the argument that God is that the God of the Bible is the moral lawgiver for this standard, I highly recommend C.S. Lewis's book, Mere Christianity, because the majority of his text is devoted to establishing that exact line of reasoning. But for the purposes of tonight, since we don't have time to dive into all things that we'd like to, I want to expand on the conclusions that come from this idea that a standard exists. And the first is this: because the straight line exists, there is goodness. The standard of what is good and right, the straight line, as Lewis called it, is not and cannot be a matter of opinion. In the same way that King says, we don't ask the question, what is popular or what is expedient? That standard of goodness comes from outside our human perception and our human popular opinion. If something is truly evil, it requires an absolute standard. And if everything in life is based on nothing more than human perception and human reasoning, there can be no real standard by which we deem something right or wrong, just or unjust. Even standards that attempt to appeal to universal themes apart from God require human opinion if left to themselves. For example, the idea that what is wrong is whatever harms the common good. Well, who defines harm? Who defines collective good? Who made the rule that harm is what defines the collective good? Without some standard of right and wrong that transcends our human authority, there is no true, real right and wrong, and therefore no ability to have justice. No straight line against which we measure the crooked. But if there is a moral lawgiver who set a standard by which we can measure whether something is just or unjust, then true goodness exists, and by converse, so does true evil. And there are several very healing truths that flow from this revelation. The first is this: if goodness exists, there is hope. No matter how dark it gets, if you can see that something is evil, it means there is goodness out there, and that gives hope. Evil does not have to be minimized. It doesn't have to be mitigated. It doesn't have to be downplayed. You can call it what it is and know that the goodness exists and there is hope. This lets you speak the truth about what happened to you without minimizing or mitigating or downplaying, without being dependent on what culture or society says about what was done to you. You are not dependent on society's response to know if something is just or unjust and to be able to grieve it. You can grieve the damage even if others minimize or excuse it. And learning to grieve the damage in ways that are non-destructive is the first step in reaching healing. And that's not an easy step to take. So the first thing we see is that there's a standard and it exists and it brings freedom. The second implication is this: the moral lawgiver who defines goodness cares about justice and evil. In the Christian faith, right and wrong flow not from some capricious decision that God makes, but from the very goodness and holiness of God, from his very being and his essence. And so in the Christian faith, the reason that we feel evil so keenly is because it is such an aberration from the incredible goodness of our loving Father. Such an aberration from the one who defines that straight line. And because goodness and evil exist in opposition to each other, in contrast, the more one understands the good, the more you will understand and be able to recognize the evil. This means that God, as the ultimate standard of goodness, feels and recognizes and understands the evil even more keenly than I do. And what this really means ultimately is that it matters. My abuse matters to God because he understands it even better than I do. And here's where we see, if we apply the definition of justice to my abuse, here's where we start to see a little bit of tension. Because that last element of justice was getting what is merited or deserved. So if I am desiring justice, I am desiring that my abuser gets what he deserves. And this is where we start to feel that tension and that question, can we forgive and still desire justice? If we accept that justice is conformity to an absolute standard of goodness, a standard that is set by God, then justice is a good thing. Forgiveness is also held out in the Christian faith as being right and good. So how can both be good? Well, to understand that, we need to get very basic again. What is forgiveness? You know, Martin Luther King Jr. talked beautifully about forgiveness. That is one of the hallmarks of his social justice movement, is that is the nonviolence that he preached and the love for his oppressors that he preached. And you will see this reflected again, even just in a very simplistic dictionary definition of forgiveness. Forgiveness is giving up resentment and a claim to retaliation. It is giving up resentment and a claim to retaliation. And there are two key things about this definition that really helps us understand how forgiveness and justice intersect. The first is this. In the definition of forgiveness, notice that the thing being released is personal to me. I am giving up my vengeance, my retaliation, my bitterness. But justice comes from outside me. Justice is conformity to an absolute standard. And that standard exists even when I give up my personal vengeance. Forgiveness is my personal response to my abuser. Justice is ensuring that an outward standard is followed. And it is this reality that allowed men like King to powerfully advocate for justice, and yet advocate just as strongly for loving and forgiving the abuser. This means I can be bitter and retaliatory and never see justice. And it means that I can pursue justice and yet forgive. And the second dynamic that we see with this is a very simplistic truth that if there is a moral lawgiver, the straight line, then there is someone that is higher than me who is capable of meeting out full justice. Justice does not depend on what I do ultimately. And this is one of the areas where I find that the Christian faith portrays the most beautiful and true picture of both forgiveness and justice. The Christian faith teaches that not only does God love, but that God is just. That he pours out wrath on evil because he cares. Because he loves. Because evil is even more glaring and blatant to the Creator than it is to us. And I absolutely love the way Martin Luther King Jr. explained this. He said that the ringing testimony of the Christian faith is that God is able. And very often, we think of the idea of God punishing and God's wrath being seen as something that is negative and vengeful. But what we need to understand tonight, what I want you to understand tonight, is that punishment for evil, the bringing of justice, does not happen because God does not love, but because he does love. When my innocence was stolen as a young child, twice over, God saw that damage, and he said, "This is evil, and it matters to me. What happened to me matters, and it is seen, and it is heard, and someone cares, when no one else did." And if we really think about it, would we want it any other way? Now think back to another quintessential sexual assault case we had in the last few years, the Brock Turner case. The young woman who was victimized in that case got up and testified powerfully to what Turner had taken from her. And what was the judge's response? 6 months. 6 months in prison, and he got out in 3. Did the whole world stand up and say, "Look at that judge. Look at how loving and compassionate that judge is. We need more judges like this." That is not what we did. We intrinsically knew that the most unloving thing that judge could do for both parties was to pretend that that evil wasn't as evil as it was, to minimize it, to mitigate it, to act like it didn't matter. And the only reason a judge does something like that is when he doesn't care. But that is not the kind of God that we have. But the Christian faith goes one step further even than that. Not only does God love and bring justice, but then God offers to take that justice upon himself to make forgiveness possible. The Christian faith teaches that God's love requires justice and requires punishment for sin because evil is real and it matters. But it also teaches that God, in his love and mercy, gave himself to allow that justice to be poured out on him. This is what is referred to in Christianity as the coming to earth to sacrifice himself for our sins. Christ took the punishment, the justice, on himself. And because of this, in the Christian faith, those who repent, turn from their evil, and place their faith in Christ will no longer receive what they deserve. Not because it doesn't matter. Not because what they did wasn't wrong. But because someone else took their place. But either way, justice is still done. Because the evil is real and it matters and God cares. Only in the Christian faith do we have a God who unfailingly loves enough to always bring justice, but also unfailingly loves enough to take that justice upon himself to make forgiveness possible. And this means that I have been a recipient of that incredible love too. I had someone stand in my place. That was one of the most incredible, powerful things about sitting there and watching that sentence again and looking at Larry, sitting in the chair, listening over and over and over again to all the evil things he had done being held up in front of him. And I watched that and I thought to myself, what if I were in that chair? I'm not Larry. I'm not a serial pedophile. But if every nasty, wicked thing that I thought or said or done was held up in front of me in a courtroom, how hard would that be? Coming face to face with my own ugliness. But I had a God that took my place. And it also means that if I have a God that is strong enough to forgive even someone like Larry, that is the most secure place I could ever be. Because his love is strong enough to keep me too. That's someone that I can trust when I can't trust anyone else. Someone who sees my abuse and who said that matters to me. And I will bring justice for that. And that was evil because I am so. And that is why the quote by C.S. Lewis that he finishes Mere Christianity with is just incredibly powerful to me. Lewis says, Christianity, if false, is of no importance at all. But if true, is of infinite importance. The one thing it cannot be is moderately important. I believe in Christianity as I believe the sun has risen. Not only because I see it, but because